Good morning, Chris.
Good morning.
Good to see you.
Good to be seen this fine Lord's Day.
Hi, Lisa.
Hey, Lisa.
Hi, everyone.
Okay. And what I try to do when people come in is to, if they see the list here, is to go to the little one and sort of make it go up here, because it doesn't show online.
So that wouldn't show anyway. You know that overlay? It doesn't record that.
It does.
It does?
Yeah, it does.
Really?
When I do that.
Okay.
Yeah, it's really strange.
Okay. When I do it at work, it doesn't do that.
I know, right?
But okay.
Now let me do the Facebook thing again, because this is another.
So basically, when that pop-out comes in, I'll minimize it.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to St. James Presbyterian Church here in the corner of 141st Street and St. Nicholas Avenue in the village of Harlem in the city of New York. We are grateful that you are with us today here in the sanctuary. We are grateful that you are with us here on Zoom and Facebook, and we want to move right into worship and asking God to continue to give us a clean heart. I want to encourage you today with the first scripture of our day, which is the Psalm of the Day. The Psalm of the Day that many find familiar. It is familiar and comforting, a psalm of trust for many faith traditions, believe it or not. And it is Psalm 23. Later on, we'll read it in the King James Version, but for now, hear it in the New Revised Standard Version. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. But even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table for me in the presence of my very enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Amen and amen. Thanks be to God. Psalm 23. I now would like to move forward in our worship with our call to worship with Ruling Elder Andrea Bradford, who is with us online, and she is our liturgist from Huntsville, Alabama. Moved there for a while, but she's been a member here for so long, and a beautiful voice and spirit in this congregation. Ruling Elder Andrea Bradford.
Good morning, and thank you so much for those words of welcome, and it's just a blessing and an honor and a privilege to be with you here. Praise God for technology, and we can come together in ways that we may not ever have done so just a few years ago. So welcome, everyone, and we continue this worship service after hearing our beautiful favorite 23rd Psalm. With our call to worship, let us say it responsively, we continue to be in awe of the miracle of miracles. You conquered the grave for our souls.
Jesus will never forget what you've done for us, and we bless your holy name.
How will we praise Christ today and forevermore?
We start by claiming the blessed assurance that Jesus is ours.
Jesus is mighty, worthy, loving, and we say hallelujah. We say thank you.
How good it is to know that we got Jesus, and that's enough. He's a friend in the time of need, a doctor in the sick room, and a lawyer in the courtroom. The risen Jesus is the rock of our salvation. So let us worship. I know that my Redeemer lives is found in your blue hymnals. And if it's in your bulletin, that number for you, and you see the words here on screen. I know that my Redeemer lives.
He lives my
Amen. Amen. I hear people singing, and we know that our Redeemer lives. Every verse of that beautiful hymn starts with He lives. Yeah. And so we are reminded that Christ lives. We also want to pray. This belief is grounded in our word and in prayer and in our faith. And so we have this first prayer in this time of prayer, this prayer of adoration. Most gracious one, as we count our blessings this week, we have been awed by your goodness and mercy.
Yes.
We will find ways to embrace our family, friends, and even though we may be alone,
wow,
we are blessed by the bounty of not just food and things,
well,
but of your abounding love.
Yes.
For we realize that you have dominion over all the earth, the birds in the sky, the harvest from the fields, the pure water that flows from mountaintops. And we know your voice as you share with us, give to us, lavish upon us in times like these and always.
Amen. We will sing this refrain of, O Lord my God, you are worthy to be praised, 3 times. Think about what it means to adore God and say, you are worthy to be praised.
Your wonderful name, 'cause you're King of Kings. will bless. Bless your wonderful name, because you're King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and you are worthy to be praised. Let all heaven and earth thy name proclaim. You're the Lord my God, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and you are.
And here is our call to confession. We are forgiven. Yes, this we know. And yet we must still bring our faults and the harm we have done and lay it at the feet of the throne of mercy. Yeah. We do it together to remind ourselves that all have sinned and fallen short.
Yes, we have.
So let us confess now together, saying this prayer to Jesus.
We are but sheep in your pastures, good shepherd. You lead us to plush meadows and cool water. And yet in our midst are the weak, small, and those whose blemishes are there for all to see. They are often left hungry, thirsty, and often left to die as prey for the sly foxes circling, waiting to attack. We confess that instead of sheltering them in the midst of us, far too often we push them aside to the margins of our fold. Teach us to be like you, Jesus, so that we may tend to the least of these as you care for us. Let us think about that and bring our private prayers of confession in silence to God. The one time Jesus was that spotted, blemished, according to the world, sheep pushed aside by the flock. But now we get to behold the Lamb who died for us and rose for us. Now behold the Lamb, the precious Lamb of God, born into sin that we may live again, the precious Lamb of God. But I always didn't do right. I went left, you told me to go right, but I'm standing right here in the midst of my tears, Lord, and I claim you to be the Lamb of God. Oh, holy is the Lamb, the precious Lamb of God.
why you love me so, I shall never ever know the precious Lamb of God. Even when I broke your heart, all my sins, they tore us apart. But I'm standing right here in the midst of my many tears. I'm gonna claim you to be the Lamb of God. Oh, thank you for the Lamb, the precious Lamb of God. Because of your grace, I can finish this race. You're the precious, precious Lamb of God. New life, it can begin. For you washed away every one of my sins. And whom the Son sets free is truly free. So we claim you to be the Lamb of God. So now behold the Lamb, the precious Lamb of God. Born into sin that we may live again, the precious Lamb of God.
Oh, Jesus.
Yes, we praise God for the precious Lamb. And we know that God forgives us when we step away from the path. We have this assurance of pardon. Rest assured, beloved, just as the shepherd hears the cry of one lost sheep, so Jesus hears our prayers. And be certain that just as the shepherd goes to find and bring back home that lost sheep, so Christ's gift blesses us with grace and mercy and will bring us home every time we stray. And when he calls, may we always say, yes.
Amen, amen. May our prayers always be in the name of Jesus, because that is where we find our victory. Thanks be to God.
In the name of Jesus, we have the victory.
tell me, who can stand before us when we call on that great name? Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, we have the victory. Amen.
And amen. And we do indeed have the victory battle by battle, because the war is God's, but each battle we win. And we may lose a few, but we have the victory ultimately. Good morning and welcome to St. James Presbyterian Church. Here we are on this little old corner of 141st Street and St. Nicholas Avenue in this village of Harlem in the city of New York. And we welcome you to worship. We are so grateful that you are here with us. We are grateful for you when you go to YouTube and watch it afterwards. We're grateful for you when you go to Facebook, and you, those of you who are on there, feel free to write in the chat in Facebook. Feel free to write in the chat and also in our Zoom room, because we will attend to those prayers, and your other people that are there with you love to interact with you. So if you see somebody say amen back to you, sisters. Amen back to you, brother. Make sure we celebrate that we are indeed in worship with one another, and we are looking forward to what God has in store for us. First and foremost, we have one major community announcement to make, and we would like to say congratulations to Brother Anthony Terrell. Deacon Anthony Terrell, on tomorrow, his birthday, will be celebrating 50 years of marriage.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Yeah, y'all can clap for that. Hey. As Brother Anthony is taking a bow, all of you who are at home, he's taking a bow. So this is a wonderful, momentous occasion, and we are grateful that you share that with us, and that you wrote me and said, Pastor, can you please say, just say it online, let people know. Mm-hmm. It's been 50 years, so congratulations.
Wow.
And thanks be to God for you, and for Gwen, and for all the love that your family and everything that you all have produced together. You know, it's just been so wonderful. So thanks be to God. And we'll keep you all in our prayers. Amen. Amen. You are welcome. You are welcome. I also want to just let you know that we will have Bible study tomorrow evening. Bible study, it is at 6 p.m., right?
Yeah, that's it.
And I'm here in the sanctuary, or in the session room, because if it's warmer, I'll be in the session room, so you all can join us. It's been a little bit warmer in the building yet, so we've been able to roam around a lot. It's been nice. And also from 6 to 7:30, and then on Tuesdays from at 5 o'clock, from 5 to 5:30, we have what we call a little prayer break. We stop in the middle of our day and just look at a scripture verse, talk amongst ourselves, and then we pray, and then we go. And it's a wonderful opportunity to remember to stop, because God has got you. You know, just think about all the times that God has so much to do. What if God didn't stop for us? Now, there's a new feature on our website, like www.stjamesharlemnyc.org. That's www.stjamesharlemnyc.org. We'll have a slide that'll show that in a moment. But on that, you'll be able to see, if you go to calendar, you'll see the worship service. You'll see our Bible study link. You'll see our prayer service link. And next month, you're going to see the women's book club link as well. So we are making sure that you have access to everything that you need if you want to be a part of the St. James family, not just here on Sunday morning, but in the life of the church. Because the life of the church is what keeps the church humming and breathing and running, so that when we come together on Sunday, we say, hallelujah, and thank you, God, for being together. So we encourage you to join us in our Bible studies, in our prayer break, in our book club, and several other things that will be happening. We have, our multicultural festival is coming up on June 22nd. And if you don't come out on Sunday, come out on Saturday and come and see how our community comes together with the arts from all over Manhattan, from all different parts of the world. And this is sponsored as well with the community police precinct at number 30, at precinct 30. Community police wanted our young people to say, how can we build a better relationship with our community? And so this is what has happened with this, and this is the 15th year. And it has been in front of St. James ever since the very beginning. So on June 22nd, we will be here. June 1st, it's in Jackie Robinson Park. But we want you all to come out here. Mm-hmm. Come out here and support the vendors and so on and so forth. And thanks be to God for that. There was something else I was going to mention. Oh, that's what it is. Yeah. Anniversary. That's what it is. I knew it was something else. But I put a bulletin, put a thing in the bulletin, so I'm going to read it directly. Let's see, but where did I put it? I'm going to put it in here. On Sunday, April 28, 2024, St. James will be celebrating its 129th anniversary. Mm-hmm. That's 129 years of ministry, y'all, here in the city of New York. St. James extends the legacy of our mother church, Shiloh Presbyterian, founded in 1822. Now, part of our stewardship for our friends and family and for our members is to share an offering of $1 for each year in ministry. So your $129 will celebrate this milestone. You might also consider sharing an offering on behalf of a loved one, a youth, as a promise to our future, or friends and families and loved ones, or other members who you know may not be as blessed as you are. So we ask you to all help us in this offering, to help us with our ministry. And we do look forward to not just working with you here, but to seeing more of you in here. And if you tell us that you're coming next week and you let us know by going to our you can email me at pastor141@verizon.net or the church at St. James 409@verizon.net, then you can actually let us know and maybe we'll have another delicious coffee hour for you. So we really want to do that and build community for our anniversary. And I have a couple of surprises that I'm working for. That I want you to all be aware of. So come on out and share with us not just 129 years of the past, but what's going to be happening in the future in this church. Thanks be to God.
Yes.
Something to consider. I saw this on, maybe it was on TikTok. No, it was on my Instagram feed. But I said, I'm going to share this with us today. God didn't add another day because you needed it. God added another day because someone needed you. God did not add another day because you needed it. God added it because someone needed you. May that be something that we put on our refrigerators and hold in our heart. Mm-hmm. July 27, 2024, we will be doing a trip to our Presbyterian camp in Holmes, New York. Holmes Presbyterian Camp is one of our Presbyterian camps. It's Free Presbyterians, Long Island, and Hudson River Valley. It's all of ours, but they're having an open house, and we're going to get in the van and cars, and we're going to drive an hour out of the city into the country. I'm going to watch y'all in the lake. I'll go on a hike. I'll bring out my shoes and go out on a hike in the property. This is one of the most wonderful secrets, hidden secrets of our presbytery. We've had some presbytery meetings there, and we really want our young people and our older young people to come and join us as well. It's going to be wonderful. So we look forward to that, and you'll be hearing more about that. So, is there anything else that I need to share on the slides in terms of information for people?
The men's group will be
when?
The 26th. Friday, 11 o'clock.
Friday the 26th.
It's next Friday.
The Presbyterian men will be meeting the next Friday.
The
26th, Friday coming. And they will be meeting at 11 a.m. You can reach out to the church in order to get that Zoom information. And we'll put that on the website as well. So people will know how to be a part of everything. So our website's gonna be the place to go.
Come on.
And I'm working, hopefully, with one of our young people to get another social media presence with Instagram and with TikTok, because that's their field. So I'm going to let them do it. So we're going to get out there in the world and continue. But I am going to encourage you to at least indulge this old man and go to our Facebook page. And like us and join us on Facebook and join us on YouTube as well. so that we'll be able to maybe start streaming and doing other things on YouTube. You need a certain amount of members on YouTube in order to avail yourselves to that, and also in order for people to find you, to sponsor you, to give you money for what you do. We are entrepreneurs here as well, entrepreneurs for God. Amen, amen. So with that, and with these announcements, I believe that is all that I'm so grateful that you all raised your hands and lifted up your hands for me, because this brain, a lot goes out. No, that's because a lot is being held in it, in terms of our scriptures and our message for today. So thanks be to God. Ruling Elder Andrea Bradford, what you doing?
Yes, yes, sharing love, and it's so great to hear about what's going on in the community, and just get ready for that anniversary next week. It's just the years keep coming, and the years will continue, and we have to be there to continue with them and support our young people in continuing to build and develop and manage our church. Amen. They are the next generation and the generations to come. And so it's such a happy time now, this next week, getting ready for anniversary. So let us share some love now, understanding that Christ has peace that he shared. The peace of Christ is and refreshes as the still and living waters. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also
with you.
I would love to, yes. Okay. So let's do that. You and I will work on that, okay?
That's okay.
Surprise.
I was gonna say, did you want to tell everybody that's online now or actually in the audience? Make it easy on your life for this week.
Everyone, you have an iPhone or a phone that takes a video or anything. Next week, we're gonna have a session in our service where we're going to ask you to tell your favorite memory of St. James. Think about it. Shantae and I have been working on this. She gave me some ideas and some language, and so we're also working with our young people to share. They may send us videos, and if they can get here, they will. And we're really looking forward, because not only is this about, and Shantae was really good about observing this, not only is it good to hear about what your favorite moments are, but also helps us to think about where we go in the future.
Yes.
Especially with our young people, when we hear what it is that they like and what they need. So, Shantae, is there anything else that you wanted to say about that?
No, I'm super excited, because not only are we sending this to the young folk, we're actually sending it to everybody. So if you have one of your friends that actually participated or even came to any of our any Sundays, you can definitely ask them if they wanted to send a video as well, because we want this to actually be like a big thing so that everybody can feel like, you know, feel the love of St. James. So it's only like a 15 to 30 second, just a little clip just to let us know how you feel about St. James.
And you can send that to pastor141@verizon.net. pastor141@verizon.net, and it will be edited into a reel. I got a lot of work to do this week. So, and if, for example, there's a time when you say, well, you know, I don't know how to do that on my phone or whatever, just email me and I'll make some time where you can come here and I'll put up the camera and you can just speak and we'll talk and we'll edit that also. So I know how to do this stuff, y'all. So all you got to do is show up and share. Okay. Thank you, Shantae, for reminding me about that. I'm so excited about that project. So
me too. No problem.
All y'all. Amen. 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 Spread the word. Also, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about the beauty of our session. As you know, we always ask for offering. We're always asking for money, right? But it's not just about asking for money. It's about the stewardship that we have in our hearts. However, there is now a new financial stewardship task force. And we had our first meeting. And one of the beautiful things about the meeting is setting up goals and setting up ideas. And it's not just about It's about other ways of going into the community and finding out how we may be able to amend what it is that we're doing here at St. James with offerings and with other grants and things that gets us out into the community. For example, we do work with young people all the time. We do work in this community all the time. And there is a funding agency that is specific to this community right here, where we might be able to work with and see how we might be able to fund some of our programming so that we can get back out there in the world. So we are excited about these opportunities, as well as opportunities how we may be able to figure out how to better move our stewardship and to work within our Presbyterian Foundation, all these wonderful things as well. So I'm excited about the input that people have in their ideas and thinking about that. And finally, and I'll do this more and more as soon as I hear more or see it on Facebook, I will bring it up again. Maurice and Amari, congratulations on making the honor roll.
Good.
I think I saw something online, Marisa, thank you. I think I saw something online that said, not just one, but my two boys. Yeah. And they're standing in this beautiful picture with one another, just sort of saying, look what we did. Yeah. So congratulations on your work. I'm so proud of you, and we're looking forward to hearing more. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Anytime, anytime. I'm ruling out Andrea Bradford. Are you ready to move forward now that we've shared this beautiful community life as the fly?
I am. Congratulations, Maurice and Amari. It's just so wonderful to hear the good work you're doing. Just keep it up. Set the standard. Make them come to you. You're the ones that can make it happen. So we are just proud. But we know you got it. So you just keep going, and we're with you, behind you, beside you, in whatever way we can be. Amen. So thank you, Maurice. You know, I've been following you for a long time. So y'all just keep it up. So let us now move to the time in our service where we get a chance to get some inspiration. Some inspiration from the hearing of the word, and the hearing of the word in the Bible, but also the hearing of the word that the pastor has had put on his heart by the divine intervention. So let us begin this time of hearing the word and reading the word with our prayer of illumination. Can we say this together?
Peace to us as you do when you have us rest in green pastures. Reveal yourself in the word. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We have three scriptural passages this morning. The first is from the book of Acts, the fourth chapter, verses 5 through 12. Acts, the fourth chapter, verses 5 through 12. The next day, their rulers, elders, and scribes assembled in Jerusalem, with Annas, the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen. Whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead.
Yes.
This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builder. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved. Mm-hmm. And our second reading from 1 John, the third chapter, verses 16 through 24. 1 John, the third chapter, verses 16 through 24. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses to help? Mm-hmm. Little children, let us love. Not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from him whatever we ask because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this, we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us. And our third reading, according to John, the 10th chapter, verses 11 through 18. John, the 10th chapter, verses 11 through 18. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen and amen. Thank you for that. Young people, I want you to look at this slide that we have for you for our Let the Children Come moment today. And it is simply entitled today, That 23rd Psalm. Yeah, that one. The one that everybody talks about, the one that everybody knows. But I want you to look at this photograph, this painting, because this painting was actually done in 1863. Now, what is strange about this painting that was done in 1863? of this African-American man. This was written actually on the heels of the Emancipation Proclamation. This was painted. What is strange? What do you notice? What you notice is that there's an African-American man reading. It is against the law, of course, for those who were enslaved to read. And yet, here is this man depicted reading the Bible, the 23rd Psalm. Mm-hmm. What does that say about the power of God's words to speak deliverance to a people? It says, God's got us in the midst of all of our troubles, and the fact that it was painted right after Emancipation Proclamation, there's a joy in the fulfillment of the 23rd Psalm being answered for that man in there. And it's a beautiful, beautiful portrait. So I wanted you to know about that, and I picked that up specifically because I wanted to share that, the hope that in 1863, the people who love this kind of artwork say, it is not that they should read, but that they must read. That is the mantra for everyone to be free. And I wanted to read to you the 23rd Psalm from the King James Version of the Bible, because most people that you know grew up learning this psalm like that. And I'm going to read it, and then I'm going to give you a practice that you can use in your life with these six verses. So find your favorite verse when you hear me read this. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I am going to encourage you to learn that psalm. Learn the six verses of that psalm and find your favorite verse. When we were in Bible study, Miss Andrea said that the verse that spoke to her was, "He restoreth my soul." And then I got to thinking, every verse can be followed with the whatever verse you pick out. So we say, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He restored my soul. Yea, though I walk through the valley and shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, and thy rod and staff, they comfort me. He restored my soul. If you say, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures, he leads me beside the still waters. He restored my soul. And you can pick whatever verse you want and tag it on to the end of another verse. And it gives you strength and it feels good. So if you learn these six verses, just these six verses out of this entire book, just these six verses, if you memorize those, you will have strength and you will have a way to answer all of the issues in life when you're worried, when you're afraid, it can restore your soul. So that's your job now, is to learn this song like we all had to as adults when we were growing up. But learn the 23rd Psalm, not just to memorize it, but because it will bring you through so many different times. I'll leave you with this. One person in our Bible study said, she was walking along the street with a friend, and people came up to them like they were going to attack her. And she said, yea, though I walk through the valley in the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. She said it over and over and over, and those people turned away from them. That's how God works. Most gracious and loving God, we thank you for Psalm 23. We thank you for being a shepherd. We thank you for your voice. We thank you, O God, for all of the promises that you give us. And we thank you, O God, in this moment, that whenever we need our souls restored, that we can go to these six verses in the name of Jesus, and it will be so. Amen and amen.
Look unto me. fantastic.
Oscar said that when he was younger, the Maxwell Trio used to sing that song. Thanks be to God. I love that song. Thank you, everyone. Amen. I heard the voice of Jesus say, to know the shepherd's voice. My God, to know the shepherd's voice. In the Gospel of John, Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. Come unto me. Psalm 23 says, the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. These two book-ended scriptures are about what God does for us. How God, even in the midst of our worries and trials, God's got us like a shepherd has every sheep in their flock. Now, when you hear the phrase, thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies, let's think about that a little bit. And let's back it up to what that really may have meant to the Israelites back then. For 40 years, they wandered in a desert, right? For 40 years, they weren't just wandering in the desert, they were wandering through homelands of other people, enemies, the Amalekites. They were wandering through Rephidim. And you have this large group of people wandering through other nations. And they aren't too happy about it. They are walking in the midst of their enemies. And yet, what are they eating? Manna. Quail. Where is their water? Coming from rocks in the middle of the desert. So what do all their enemies see around them? They see God preparing a table for God's own people, while all the enemies get to watch and say, how in the world are these people still making it for 40 years in the wilderness? They've got quite a God. This is the promise of Psalm 23 as well. And it's also this lying down in green pastures. Where do you find green pastures in the midst of a land full of desert? The shepherd leads you. They forage out the spaces and find out the pathways in which to take you so that you can find your fill of green grass. Where do you find water? Water which you can maybe coming down from the mountainside that if you go up onto it and your feet can't get a grip, you'll fall into it head first and as sheep you will drown. No, but here we are promised that God will lead us beside still waters. God leads us beside still waters and green pastures, sets a table before us in front of our enemies. Do you see how powerful this may have been to the people of Israel who loved this psalm as well? Do you see how powerful this may have been to this man in this painting that we were just looking at a few moments ago? Do you see how powerful this psalm can be for you? Every king in the Near East is supposed to be a good shepherd. That is the image of Mesopotamia, Samaria, all the lands around them. The image of a good leader is supposed to be one that is a shepherd. Now, to be a shepherd is to dedicate yourself, your spirit, your energy to the well-being, not just of the flock, but of the household and of the community. Being a shepherd is one of the most important things that you can be in an agrarian society. Where else do you get your wool? Where else do you get your meat? You can grow wheat and bread all you want, where do you get this sustenance? Even so, when I shave in the morning, I have cocoa butter on one hand and lanolin in the next. And I pour a thick drop of lanolin on my hand and put in some alcohol there and rub it on my face afterwards. Lanolin is the oil that naturally comes from sheep. If you meet any shepherd and you touch their hands, it will be just as soft as velvet because of lanolin. It holds in the moisture. Just a drop holds in the moisture. Heals and soothes the skin. So we think about the sheep only as being food and only as being wool, but think about the lanolin. When there's a windstorm in the wilderness, how do you protect your skin? With lanolin. You play with your sheep and you touch your sheep and you shave your sheep, and then you feel that in your hands and you take that oil and you make it baby safe. You touch your lover's face with that soft hand. The good shepherd makes sure that every one of those sheep contains all of the essence that they're supposed to, without being in danger, by guiding them and bringing them home also. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I am here to protect the most valuable gift that you have. I am here to protect that when you touch someone's heart, that they feel the softness of the love of God. I am the good shepherd. I am fostering you so that if someone needs to be clothed in righteousness, you as my sheep take your woolen cloak and wrap it around them. The metaphors abound with this good shepherd language. And it's a beautiful, beautiful notion that is just so simple. In the book of Proverbs, even as the sheep are coming down from Mount Gilead, shepherds watch and compare that to their lover's hair. Wavy hair coming down the shoulders of their lover, the way that it looks coming down from the mountain as the sheep are descending. But if you're a hired hand to take care of the sheep, you're not looking for all that stuff. You're not looking for the lanolin, you're not looking for the wool, you're not looking for the meat. All you're looking for is the shekel, the denarius. All you're looking for is the dollar bill. So when Jesus is saying, I'm the good shepherd, and giving us this example in Psalm 23 is, what does that mean for us? Well, what are we supposed to do when we are supposed to be doing the work of Christ on this earth? Are we good shepherds? Or are we hired hands? Are we just hired hands that can say, oh, okay, I'm getting my paycheck at the end of the day, I'm closing my door. When my father had his stroke before he passed away, this social worker could have just said, I'm a hired hand, when he couldn't speak for 6 weeks. And after 6 weeks, he said, Derek McQueen, find Derek McQueen. The only words that he could say after 6 weeks of a massive stroke, and she went home on Facebook and searched for days. And she saw a photograph and said, you look like the one he's talking about. And she contacted me, and my lost father was found. I was able to go down to Florida and take care of him. Let the rest of his brothers and sisters who live right there in Florida know where he was. She was not just a hired hand. Yes. She cared.
Do you see what a difference it makes when you decide that you're not just a hired hand, but you want to be a shepherd? Do you see the difference that it can make in a life?
Yes.
That's what we're talking about here in this scripture. It is real. What good is it if you have riches and you shut them up and you see your neighbors without? You're just like a hired hand. And a shepherd will go that extra duty, that extra duty to make sure that that weak and tired little sheep, little lamb, will be found before it's time to be round up to go home. Because the foxes are always on the edges, looking for the weakest to attack. The foxes that are outside are not looking for you when you're strong. They find you in your weakness.
That's right.
And they watch you. They watch for you to stumble. And they watch for when you stumble, how others will let you stumble because they are just hired hands. And then they will come around the back and they will snatch you. We have work to do being the shepherds that Christ calls us to be. How many wolves are out there snatching up our weak? Snatching up our young. Snatching. We are meant to be the good shepherd with a vocation. Our vocation in the Lord is to make sure that all are safe and all can come to this banquet table that God prepares for us. To hear the voice of the shepherd. When you hear Jesus speaking to your heart about what you can do and what you are called to do, there's nothing like it. There's nothing that anybody can say to you that can take that voice out of your head. When you hear a song that speaks to you in the name of Jesus, it stays on your heart. When you hear a word in the name of Jesus, it stays on your heart. When you hear a prayer in the name of Jesus, it stays in your heart. When you hear a testimony in the name of Jesus, it stays on your heart. So listen for the voice. We get to be taken care of and to also take care of. How incredible this bounteous gift from God is that because God is our good shepherd and Jesus says, I am your good shepherd, because of that, we know how to take care of others. Just like every king was supposed to know and humble themselves like a shepherd to say, the least of these is mine that I will take care of. Just as God is the shepherd, every king is to be the shepherd. Just as Jesus is the shepherd, so are we to be the shepherd, because we know what it's like to be taken care of. We know what it's like to be loved. We know what it's like to be held in our hard times. We know, and if you know, then do better. And give to someone else who needs to know that life can be good in the arms of Christ. Life can be good if they would stop and just listen. Shepherd's voice. My God. Even right now, New York is silent, listening for the shepherd's voice. These moments, understanding just this simple concept of the good shepherd and what we are called to do, how we are called to respond. If something good happens to you, there's a thing where they say, pay it forward. I say, pay it simultaneously. If God is blessing you, bless another.
Yes.
If the good shepherd has led you to a good place, bring another.
Yes.
Yes.
If you see someone on the margins who needs a good shepherd, tell them that these doors are open. Tell them that your heart is open. Tell them that the arms of Jesus are open. My brothers and my sisters, the Lord is my shepherd. I lack for nothing. Be in those six verses with Jesus as your good shepherd, preparing your table. And even though your enemies are around you, when they finally see the goodness of God, tell them there's a cup for you at this table that we are glad to share with you in the name of Jesus. To hear the shepherd's voice. This, O God, is our plea on this day, that you would settle our spirits and settle our worries and sit us down at that banquet table in the midst of our enemies, who may not be people, they may be bills. They may be political entities. They may be social things that are happening in the world that weigh us down. Still, sit us down at this table so that we can recognize that your grace and your mercy and your ability to shepherd us will never change. Hold us and keep us, so that, Good Shepherd, when we come down from the mountain, like our bulletin cover, oh Master, let us walk just with you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Our responsive hymn is, O Master, Let Me Walk With Thee. And hear these words.
parade. You know, with Bible study and prayer break and phone calls throughout the week and visits, there is much to be prayed for in this world. How is it that you have a rainstorm of biblical proportions in the middle of the desert in Dubai? How is it that you have someone so pushed to the limit about whatever it was, they set themselves on fire? All of these things that are happening in the world, and yet our lives still go on too. We worry about places to live. We worry about medical conditions. We worry about a young man in Far Rockaway who needs prayer. So Jehiah, we lift you up as well. And pray that congregation may be led to will feed your soul. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we come to you now in thanksgiving for all that you do for us. In the midst of all the things that we've named, you are still present, you are still there, and you are still with us. You remind us that 50 and 50 plus years of having a partner in our lives is a blessing. You remind us that even if we haven't had a partner for that long, that the memory of those who have loved us and that we have loved still fills our heart with gratitude. We thank you, O God, that you have brought us such a mighty and long way. We will never know what the future holds, but we know it's going to be all right if we're in your arms. So we thank you, O God, for that. God, on our prayer list, we have so many on our hearts that you know, and many that we cannot speak aloud. Sometimes we don't speak our prayers aloud because if we hear them, it would break our hearts over and over. But those that we can name, for those who are healing from amputations, those who are adjusting to coming home from rehab, those who are learning of new illnesses and new diseases and living with them day by day. God, we pray and we lift up our prayers that you may hear us so that you may touch them and you may grace them with your presence in their lives. We ask, oh God, that you would bless the trauma of our children living in a world that is so broken, and where there is so much access to so many traumatic things. I ask that you would shield their hearts, shield their spirits, to know that just because the world is broken, they are not broken. Let every one of our young people feel whole and ready to grow in you. May they see the plans that you have for them and run on and run on and run on. God, we ask that you would bless faith congregations as people are emboldened to say, I don't want to go to church, I can't deal with church. Let them come into the sanctuary. Church on the outside, but let
in sanctuary where we need only you and one another to tend to our spirits. Help us, O God, to make our lives a living sanctuary for you. Lord, you know how tired some of us are. You know how weary some of us are. In our bulletin, there's a quote from Psalm 116, verse 12, that I've kept in there now moving forward. It simply says, "What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me?" I want you to think about the bounty that God has given to you. And ask yourself, what shall I return to the Lord? We know we can't pay it back. But we can celebrate and give thanks to God. So as you look into your hearts, remember that if you're at home and online, you can go to www.stjamesharlemnyc.org. And on that front page, if you scroll down, you'll see a PayPal button. Bright and yellow. And you can click on that and give us your offering, your tithe, and your offering. You can even leave a note and say, "This is my $129 for anniversary." You can help us do the work that God is calling us to do, that you are a part of. It's not just us. You are a part of it. You're here with us. You've listened. You prayed, you sang,
ministry. What shall you return? The bounty that God has given to us. Let us have our offering. And you know how everybody loves this song. Loving God, we thank you for these offerings that are coming from within and coming from without. We thank you for your presence in our lives as you guide us, dear shepherd, and how to feed your flock with these offerings. We ask that you would bless us and keep us and touch all of those so that their hearts may be open to give, and that they cannot give, that a way be made to supply all needs. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen.
Amen.
And so, let us end our worship service on this shepherd theme. Savior, like a shepherd, lead us, is our closing hymn. It can be found at number 387 in your blue hymnals, written by William Batchelder Bradbury.
Savior, like a shepherd, lead us, much we need thy tender care. In thy pleasant pastures feed us, for our use thy foals prepare. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us thine.
It is saying that you are blessed. You have been in worship, and your hearts, may they be rich and full. The shepherd also says, go out into the world. Bless those with your love and God's grace. And let us gather back here again to move into 130 years.
Mm-hmm.
And what that brings us.
Thank you.
Yeah. So good.